Audiobook, Simply This Moment. 17 I Know You Mara, 2. 25th of August 2004. Renunciation. The second factor of the Eightfold Path is right intention, Sammasaskappa. Right. Intention is Nekkhamasaskappa, the intention to renounce. What a beautiful word. That is, to renounce. Some of you are monks, have you renounced yet? Many. People say they are renunciants, but in fact they have only renounced some things. Maybe you have renounced some things. Maybe you have renounced TV and sex. There are many other things you could yet renounce. Renounce your body. Renounce your mind. Renounce your meditation. So, just let go. Whatever the mind wants to do, that's fine, because it doesn't belong to me. Mind. You are just like the twigs, grass, leaves, and sticks of the Jada Grove, you don't belong to me. You are nothing to do with me. You are not mine, because the Buddha said there is nothing that is mine, there is nothing that belongs to me. If we can abandon and let go of all this, it doesn't mean we just abandon meditation and sleep all day. We abandon sleep as well. We abandon everything. The abandonment becomes the movement of the mind that frustrates Mara the controller. Nekkhama, giving up the world, is the metal stake through the heart of Mara the demon. It kills Mara, because Mara can't stand renunciation. We give up, renounce, abandon. With that renunciation in our meditation, we sit there and just renounce everything. This isn't mine, nothing to do with me. That renunciation, non-doing, non-controlling, takes away the movement of mind. The reason why the mind is restless and tired, the underlying cause of the hindrances, is seen and abandoned. The hindrances just unravel. Sensory desires, where can they come from? Ill will is gone. Restlessness is just doing things. Worry is about the past. Who cares about the past? That's all gone. Sloth and torpor just fades away because the cause of sloth and torpor is doing. We are tired, we think a lot. We do the work in the office or the work of being an abbot. The more we do, the more tired the mind becomes. That is the nature of the mind. When we don't do anything, the mind gets so bright. When I am on retreat, there are days when I just sit there doing nothing in the mornings and afternoons. All the energy starts to build up and I can feel it. These energies build up because I am just sitting there doing nothing. I just watch. All the energy of my life is just going into knowing. Be very careful not to allow any of that energy to go into controlling or doing anything. As an abbot, I have to do that controlling for the rest of the day, but there is a time for non-doing, non-controlling. There is a time when I meditate, then I am not an abbot, I am not in charge. That is the time when I completely let go and abandon everything. As the Buddha said in the Indriyasayutta, SN 48, if we make this abandoning the main thing, make it our mind state, we attain samadhi, we attain unappointedness of mind. That's what the Buddha said, and the Buddha didn't say things that don't work. We make abandoning our practice by abandoning the thought that I am in control of this meditation. We abandon all of this doing business, this measuring, this judging good and bad. I am going to abandon all of that, and then the Buddha says, we get samadhi. We get one-pointedness of mind. Try it. It works, if you've got the guts to go against Mara. The trouble is we still want to control a little bit. We still want to be the one who is doing this. We want to be the me who gets the jhanas. We can't do that, but when we disappear, get out of the way, give up all hope, all wanting, then real letting go, real renunciation, real Nekkhama, just happens. That's what is needed. We can use anicca-sanna to help us push that letting go button. We fill our minds with non-self. The Buddha's teaching in the Anattalakkhana Sutta, SN 22.59, clearly says that the five khandhas are not mine. So, what is this thing we are trying to control? We are trying to control things that just do not belong to us. Get out of the way. No wonder you get frustrated. No wonder suffering comes. We are trying to control things that aren't ours. What do we expect but suffering? We are doing things that are absolutely stupid. This delusion is so intense with many of us. You keep on meditating and then you complain to me that it's not working, and you are fed up. How stupid can you be? How can there be suffering for us if we disappear and there's no one left? It's not suffering anymore, it's just cause and effect, the world coming and going, the five khandhas going around. Now they're happy, now they're sad. There's no mental suffering left when we let go and disengage. We disengage from Caesara, we disengage from the world. The five khandhas are just the world of the five khandhas. Nothing to do with us, they're khandhas, that's all. It's just like the weather, storms, rain, wind, and then sunlight and peace again. It's cold and then it's hot again. You can't control these things. So why don't you shut up and just stop arguing with nature? Stop arguing with the nature of your body, the nature of your mind. You know what I mean by arguing? It's the argument, which keeps on saying, come on. Get in there, do some meditation. That's not good enough. That was a good one. Come on, the next one will be a good one. Come on, meditate longer. Don't sleep so much. Do it this way. You are arguing with nature, with your non-self. Forget all of that. Abandon. Let go. Sit there and do nothing and you'll find that the mind does start to become still. Abandoning the hindrances. The five hindrances are the cause for the lack of samadhi. The lack of samadhi is not caused by lack of effort. For most people in the West, we make too much effort. We just don't know how to let go, how to relax. Lack of samadhi is caused by the hindrances being too active. So, put your focus on what those hindrances are, how they are caused, where they come from and why. The hindrances are the fuel for avijja, delusion. The Buddha said that delusion does not have a cause, but is fueled by the hindrances. The more the hindrances are present, the more delusion is solidified, strengthened, and sustained. So abandon those hindrances by abandoning the underlying cause of the hindrances, which is doing and controlling coming from the sense of a self, and you will find that delusion vanishes. Like the mist in the morning, it just dissipates and clears. That happens when you start abandoning hindrances through the reflections of anukha, anatta, and even dukkha, impermanence, non-self, and unsatisfactoriness. Keep those clearly in your mind and the hindrances won't have much of a chance. When the hindrances aren't present, there is nothing between the mind and the jhanas. You know that. That's what the suttas and the kribhajans say. You have heard that from me many times. Many of you know from your own experience that when the hindrances go, you get into deep meditation, even jhanas. So the hindrances are the problem. It's not you, your ability or lack of ability. It's not that you aren't trying hard enough, or meditating hard enough. Look at which hindrances are present, focus on them, understand them, get to know them. They are the enemy. They are the ones that need to be overcome, so understand how to overcome them. Craving and ill will arise from doing things all the time. Present moment awareness and silence will undermine craving and ill will. When we get into present moment awareness and silence, craving and ill will are almost dead. Our restlessness is almost gone as well. The sleepiness that many of you complain about, don't worry about it. Don't worry about anything because worrying is just more controlling. That's old karma, you've done too much and the mind is not bright. Mindfulness is weak simply because we have not been putting energy into the right place. So just allow it to be. Be with sloth and torpor. If we really leave it alone, it just vanishes. It's a marvelous experience to have that happening. Just be patient, don't do anything. Be kind and be compassionate. Don't control, let go. The Buddha said in the Anattalakkhana Sutta, if the mind with sloth and torpor were mine, then I could tell it not to be this way. But because the mind isn't myself, I can't control this mind. So leave it alone, allow it to be and don't get involved. Don't go making more delusion. After a short while, it's fascinating to see sloth and torpor dissipate like the mist in the early morning or like darkness when the sun comes out. You don't have to wish the darkness away in the morning. You know if you just wait, soon due to cause and effect and the laws of nature, the sun will come up. The sun comes up and you start to see clearly without your flashlight. This is actually what happens with the vanishing of sloth and torpor. When this happens you get this beautiful, peaceful strength of mindfulness, mindfulness which doesn't move, it's just there, just watching. It doesn't move because there's no illusory self pushing it backwards and forwards. This house builder, the controller, the doer, the illusion of a self which thinks, I am in control, I am in charge of this whole process of meditation, is completely taken away. Just be still, and wait in that stillness. You are not asking for anything, you are not expecting anything. You don't want anything, because all expecting and wanting is the movement of the mind that takes you away from stillness. You are into peace, into stillness. If you get peace and stillness, that's good enough. You just sit there watching, and the peace will consolidate. The stillness becomes even more frozen. Just watch as all these stages of meditation happen. The stages of meditation are not something that we make happen. They are just signposts on a journey. It's just like when I'm sitting in the van going into town, I don't do the driving, I just watch. Now we go through Serpentine, now through Byford, now through Armadale, now through Perth and into Nottumra. They're just stages on the journey. We watch, literally doing nothing, being still 100%, being peaceful. We see present moment awareness. Now there's silence. We didn't do that, the silence came by itself. And then the breath comes up. We didn't do that, the breath just came. It is just the territory we are passing through. Now the breath is beautiful. It's okay. That's neat, but we don't do anything. Now the nimitta comes up. We never looked for it, we never asked it to come, or told it to go away, it just happens naturally. The nimitta is just so brilliant and beautiful. Then we are in jhanas and we keep on going. All these things just happen naturally, all by themselves. We didn't do a thing. All we did was to maintain our peace. We kept the stillness, and so the hindrances never had a chance. Mara the controller is completely confounded. We went in a different direction, the direction of a Buddha, not the direction of the world. We went according to anatta. There's no one in here, so how could we do anything? We didn't follow delusion, we followed wisdom, the path of the saints. That's how we meditate. That's how we get this beautiful, powerful mindfulness. Once we get into this way of meditation, it is so easy. It's an easy thing to do with so much joy. There's no pride because there's no self. There's no saying, I am a great meditator or I am a terrible meditator. There's no frustration when sometimes the meditation doesn't work, It's just cause and effect, it's not our meditation. You're content, peaceful, and still. You keep doing the work which is no work. Peacefulness and stillness, these things happen by themselves. It's just like the worker who goes to work every day and on Friday receives his pay package. He doesn't expect the pay package every day. Nature is that way. You can't get paid every moment. But you can be at peace with every moment, you can be still and content with every moment. You can renounce doing and controlling every moment, and confound Mara every moment. You just say no to the controller, no to Mara, and let go, do nothing. No one is in here. There's nothing. That way, we can really get into this meditation. We find that this is so easy. Anytime you get that powerful meditation, it blows your mind away. Stepping over the stream. Follow that path. Sit in your hut. You may have been meditating for years and still you haven't seen it, and then suddenly you let go and my goodness, you bliss out. That is how it is. It's so easy. This is how you get into the jhanas like the great monks and nuns of old, and the great monks of today. Delusion is the problem, not seeing clearly. Sometimes people get insight and become full arahants in just one moment. They get that insight after the jhana, that's the point. Even for an anagami, jhanas are so easy. Why are jhanas so easy for an anagami, let alone for an arahant? Jhanas are easy for them because they see non-self. They are not controllers anymore. Ill will and the raja of sensory desire just disappear. They see that there's no one in there, no self. That's what makes the meditation easy. Remember that this meditation of non-self has two important things that go together. Concentration, samadhi, and insight, vipassana, they are not separate things. Ajahn Chah always said that vipassana and samatha, calm, are two sides of the same coin. When we have insight and we use that insight, that knowledge and understanding of the suttas, we recognize anatta, non-self. If there is nobody in charge, then who is meditating? If there is someone meditating, then the hindrances are just around the corner. You are undermining it already, you are feeding those hindrances. The hindrances in turn are feeding the delusion and it keeps on going. One day you will giving up a try by not doing anything, just sitting there with no expectations and no measuring. People sometimes come to me and say they tried that and it didn't work. What do you mean it didn't work? It didn't work because you want it to work. Why do you want anything? Give up all wanting. Give up all these expectations and this measuring. And then it happens. When you don't want something, then it comes. So, give it up. Abandon, renounce. That's what the Buddha said we should do. You've heard that before and you know it's true. Stop messing around by trying hard. Go back to your huts, get inspired. And just sit there, and remember that there's no one in here who is going to do anything. You just stop. The story of the little novice comes to mind. Ajahn Chah was giving such a long talk. And the little novice thought, when is Ajahn Chah going to stop? The rains retreat has been going on for 4 weeks, when is this rains retreat going to end? When am I going to get nimittas? Stop for goodness sake. Stop wanting. That novice stopped. He was just a little novice who had not been meditating for any longer than some of you. The little novice just stopped and went into a jhana. He came out afterwards as probably the happiest novice in all of Yibon. He was blissed out. He had pressed the letting go button. If he had been smart, he would have understood lots about anatta. He would also have understood how to bliss out, how jhanas happen, and how to get into them. All of you who are still driving your meditation, steering it this way and that way with Your foot still on the pedal, let it go. Our new monastery car has cruise control. You press a button and take your foot off the pedal. This is like Jhana meditation. It's all cruise control. Press the letting go button and take your feet off the pedals. Then your car just goes smoothly along the freeway to Nibbana. That's what happens when you let go. So, this is what we're supposed to be doing. Do it. Stop. We find that the mind goes into samadhi by itself. It goes in and in, because peace starts to build up. That peace is happiness, and happiness is power. We get into this letting go business. But be careful, because sometimes if you are not used to abandoning, you can get into controlling again. Some people get nimittas and they think, wow. Then they try to make it this way and that way, and they wonder if it is the right or wrong nimitta. Stop that. Just be at peace whatever happens. You can get the most stupid, ridiculous nimitta, but just be at peace. Who cares? It's just nature, that's all. Things arising, things passing away, they are nothing to do with you. So it's just the same as the grass and leaves in the Jhana grove, they are not me, not mine. Here we are just sitting. Stupid and beautiful things happen in our mind, but they are nothing to do with us. Beautiful nimittas arise, but they're not ours. Leave them alone, and then the nimitta will stay with you. If you try to own them, grab them, possess them, they disappear. Leave them alone and they just develop, grow, and blossom. You will go into this wonderful place of non-self, where the doer has gone and the potential to do has also vanished. The potential to do has completely vanished. That is a signpost of the jhanas. Especially the second jhana. Oh, what bliss! Nothing to do and you can't do anything. Imagine the peace and stillness, nothing moves. The energies just keep building up, just bliss upon bliss upon bliss. The energy of stillness is now so strong. There is just so much happiness. That happiness is the power of the mind. We come out of those power stages and we still maintain lots of power. Want to remember past lives? It's easy. Psychic powers, this is where they come from. Use that superpower. Mindfulness. You can remember what has gone on in your jhana and see the beautiful, profound teachings of the Buddha, how true they all are. We see how it is that the Buddha is such a fantastic teacher. He taught and taught, banging on people's heads all the time, but still people often don't see it. There it is, in black and white, so obvious and clear. And what do people do? Right, I am going to do enlightenment now. Right, I am going to strive now. I am going to struggle. I am going to get this. I am going to do. I. Just abandon all of that silly stuff if you want to walk in the footsteps of the Buddha. Otherwise you can be here for 30, 40, 50, 60 years and still be going in the wrong direction. It's just a path to enlightenment. The Buddha's simile is crossing from this shore to the other shore. This shore to the other shore is narrower than the stream which runs through our monastery. You can step over from one side to the other side, it's so narrow. The trouble is people keep going up and down the banks in the same old direction. Going up is wanting and craving. Going down is wanting to get rid of things, ill will. Now wanting to get rid of desire and aversion, going up and down in the same way. Not seeing the other way of going at right angles to the way you are used to go. It's a way of acting which you have never tried before. Going at right angles to everything you have been conditioned to or done in the past. It's doing something that is really original, stopping. And then we find that we can just step over the stream and we get into jhanas so quickly. If you understand what that step is, You understand how to let go and how to get nibbana. Do that plenty of times and you know that the way across the stream is by abandoning, letting go. Renouncing, non-self, freedom, liberation. Conclusion. So, there it is for you. Don't mess around. Don't do anything. See if you can be the courageous ones, the ones who do things that no other people do. Don't go in the way of the ordinary person. Go the way of the Arayan, the way of those who have abandoned their self, the empty ones, those who are free self, the empty ones, those who are free self, the empty ones, those who are free self, the empty ones.